Hi, and welcome to my video series of biotechniques explained in 5 minutes, where I explain a concept of biophysical technique in less than 5 minutes or so. If you haven't yet subscribed to my channel, hit that subscribe button. I'm also present in An Academy, which is India's biggest online learning platform. Use my code AB10 to get a 10% discount in that platform. My lectures are available there. In this installment, we're going to talk about gel filtration chromatography, which is a technique by which you can separate the proteins based on their size and sometimes the molecular weight. Just like any other column chromatography, the workflow is very similar. It starts with equilibration state, followed by a binding state when the protein or the annihilate is binding to the column, followed by a wash where the non-specific binding are removed, and then the elution step when you sequentially get your purified fraction eluted. Now, let's see how gel filtration chromatography is very different from other types of column chromatography. So gel filtration chromatography has the column packed with beads which are porous. Now these beads are either made up of agarose, which are known as sephirose beads, or let's say dextran, or let's say polyacrylamide. All of these cases, it has pores inside it. So the protein samples, which are very small in the size, they can really enter the bead. And as they move through the column, they're actually retarded, because they're moving slowly through these beads. So any protein molecule which is smaller in size can enter the bead. Whereas the protein molecule which is bigger and cannot get inside the bead would try to squeeze its way through the interspace between the beads. So a big protein molecule do not enter the bead. And they are not retarded, rather they move faster than the small protein molecules. Based on this mobility, these are collected in separate fractions. Now, there is a particular term known as exclusion limit. It's a cutoff size beyond which a particular protein or a biomolecule cannot enter the pore of the bead. Below that, it can enter the pore of the bead. For example, if we say the exclusion range is 0 to 700 Dalton, anything below 700 Dalton can enter the bead, whereas anything above 700 Dalton cannot enter the bead. So based on the differential mobility, based on how proteins enter the bead or they don't enter the bead, we can get a size exclusion of these proteins, right? Now, there are various type of beads which are available in the market, such as Cefadex, which is based on dextran, Biogel P based on polyacrylamide, or sephirose, which is based on agarose. Now the proteins which are bigger size, you can clearly understand they would be eluted quickly in the elution step, whereas the protein with smaller size, which has already entered the bead, they would be retarded and hence they would be eluted later. And that is how we can separate between them based on their size. Now let's talk about few volumes, because these chromatography is semi-quantitative and we can also have a rough idea about the molecular weight of the annihilate or molecular weight of the protein we are trying to separate. So the volume which is inside the bead is actually known as the internal volume or VI, whereas the void volume means the volume which is occupied by the interspace between the beads, which is known as V0. Now void volume and the internal volume are actually related to the elution volume by this equation. The relative elution volume, which is like VE by void volume, is actually a function of the log of the molecular weight of particular protein. So by plotting a graph between them, we can extrapolate what is the molecular weight of our protein of interest. Let's say we have few standards such as BSA, cytochrome C, etc., which have different molecular weights, and we construct a standard curve. From that standard curve, we can determine what is the molecular weight of our particular protein of interest, because we always get the information about the elution and the void volume of a particular experiment. So from there, we can really calculate what is the molecular weight of our protein of interest. So I hope this is useful. If you like this video, give it a quick thumbs up. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. And do leave some comment after this video to let me know how you like my videos. It would give me so much positive motivation to make more such videos. Thank you.